Psalm 39. Psalm of David. I said, I will take heed to my ways, that I sin not with my tongue. I will keep my mouth with the bright while the wicked is before me. I was dumb with silence. I held my peace even from good, and my sorrow was stirred. My heart was hot within me. While I was musing, the fire burned. Then spake I with my tongue, Lord, make me to know mine end, and the measure of my days what it is, that I may know how frail I am. Behold, thou hast made my days as an handbreadth, and mine age is as nothing before thee. Verily, every man at his best state is altogether vanity. Surely, every man walketh in a vain show. Surely, they are disquieted in vain. He heapeth up riches, and knoweth not who shall gather them. And now, Lord, what wait I for? My hope is in thee. Deliver me from all my transgressions. Make me not the reproach of the foolish. I was dumb. I opened not my mouth because thou didst it. Remove thy stroke away from me. I am consumed by the blow of thine hand. When thou, with rebukes, dost correct man for iniquity, thou makest his beauty to consume away like a moth. Surely every man is vanity. Hear my prayer, O Lord, and give ear unto my cry. Hold not thy peace at my tears, for I am a stranger with thee, and a sojourner, as all my fathers were. O spare me, that I may recover strength before I go hence and be no more. God and his blessing to the reading of his word. Let's sing together now to the Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle, this bodily tent, were dissolved, we have a building of God, an house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven. If so be that being clothed we shall not be found naked. For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not for that we would be unclothed, but clothed upon, that mortality might be swallowed up of life. Now he that hath wrought us for the selfsame thing is God, who also hath given unto us the earnest of the Spirit. Therefore we are always confident, knowing that whilst we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Wherefore we labour that whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that every one may receive the things done in his body, according to that he hath done, whether it be good or bad. Knowing therefore the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. But we are made manifest unto God, and I trust also made manifest in your consciences. For we commend not ourselves again unto you, but give you occasion to glory on our behalf, that ye may have somewhat to answer them which glory in appearance, and not in heart. For whether we be beside ourselves, it is to God, or whether we be sober, it is for your cause, For the love of Christ constraineth us, because we thus judge, that if one died for all, then were all dead, and that he died for all, that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. Wherefore henceforth know we no man after the flesh. Yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. May God let his blessing to that further reading of his word grant us all understanding. Chapter 5 and verse 7. Second letter to the Corinthians, chapter 5, verse 7. For we walk by faith, not by sight. Very famous words. We walk by faith, not by sight. The title is Expanding Your View of Life. And that's surely what this is about. And I'd like to make mention, first of all, of the dismissal of faith in these days. These are days in the West, at least in this country, and in so much of the West, these are days of atheism, days of widespread unbelief, days of just setting to one side all things of faith and religion. Has it always been like that? And perhaps there'll come a time when it isn't like that again. But just at the moment, people, the younger generation, grow up hearing very little about faith. And so faith seems almost a peculiar thing to have. Such a strange thing. You have faith? You have faith in God? Strikes people as being tremendously strange. What's faith? People must think. Because there's such little understanding or knowledge of true religion and historic Christianity in so many quarters. What is faith? What does that mean? Is that some hit and miss attitude to life? Hoping for the best? Hoping things are true that you can't be sure of? Is that what faith means? Is it just a kind of hiding place, faith, for dependent personalities who must have a father figure, be it a God, whatever, in their lives? Is that what faith means? This is the idea. It is escapism. Just escaping from reality. Is it a kind of detachment, voluntary detachment from reality? Walking by faith. What a strange term. We walk by faith, not by sight. Doesn't sound, with today's atheistic thinking, a sensible thing to do at all. It's a suspense of reason, shutting of your eyes and hoping that your God will do something or guide you or lead you or protect you. Is that what faith is? Well, I believe that's the general impression in so many minds, and particularly younger minds, sadly, these days. It's a determination, faith, to accept something which you can't possibly prove. That's what people think. So why would we wish to promote faith in God? Why do we wish to talk about faith? Well, let me, before I proceed to that, tell you something about the advantages of faith. We walk by faith, not by sight. Walking by sight is to have an entirely materialistic outlook. And I mean materialistic in the broadest sense. In other words, there is only matter. There is no spiritual realm. There is no soul. Walking by sight, walking without faith, means you don't believe in God. You don't believe in eternal life. You don't believe in the soul. You don't believe in the spiritual realm. All you believe is in things which are composed of particles. Matter. You're a perfect materialist. You have no belief in anything outside that. That's not an easy thing to have no belief, because you actually have a very strong inner instinct to believe. And you have to dismiss that and bludgeon that out of existence and drown it in all kinds of very secular arguments and so on. This is what we do. This is rationalism. The only thing, everything can be explained. That doesn't mean we can't explain everything. But one day it's hoped that we'll be able to explain everything. Origins, the lot. The belief that everything can be explained in material terms. So you don't need faith. It's worthless. It's unnecessary. It's strange. Well, the advantage of faith, of course, is that it brings you, or can bring you, to understand matters of the soul, matters of eternity. It brings you to understand about God and what He's like and what He wants and what He requires of you. It can bring you to understand the future, future of the world, future of society and order. It can bring you to all kinds of things, faith, that purely material sight cannot see into, cannot know anything about. You can never know whether there is any purpose in life. You can never know anything about God or divine things. Yes, but that doesn't alter the fact. Does that still mean that faith is a switching off of reason and thinking power and believing in things that may not be there, which you can't prove? What is faith? Well, let me say a few things in favour of faith. Faith, actually, is extremely scientific when you just think about it. Faith is something which is based upon information. Information and events. You don't put faith in nothing. Faith has to be in something. Now then, how would you put any faith in the things of the soul, or spiritual things, or eternal things, will only by believing certain information about them? Where would you find that information? From where will it come? Ah, that's the whole point. This kind of information you cannot figure out. You cannot find it anywhere in this world except in form that is given of God. If you want to know about God, the God who is there, the true and living God, He must tell us about Himself. We can't look out of our material environment, our little box in this world, and figure out spiritual things and eternal things, things beyond our grasp, outside our dimension, far above and beyond us. God must speak. And faith, you see, is believing information which God has given, proving it to be authentic, realizing that it is authentic and profound, that it really is divine and unique, putting your trust in it, and then, because you put your trust in it, having a flood of evidence proving that your trust is not misplaced. So if God publishes His word, you may at first look at it and think, well, how do I know it is His word? Well, there are many ways in which you may know. You know it's His word because it gives explanations of life and existence and human beings which are authentic. They ring true. You prove them to be true. Nobody else is saying these things. No human literature, no human literature, all human literature has many insights, but nothing is to be compared with that which is set forward, the Bible, the Book of God, as God's Word. It is profound, it is authentic, and you come to be amazed at it and astonished at what it tells you about yourself, what it tells you about God, what it tells you about your need of Him, and how you are estranged from him because of sin, and how you need to be reconciled with him. And this, because of course the Holy Spirit is at work to help you, but this comes to you with such power and force that you realize that this is authentic, so you trust it, and you obey it, and you come to God on the terms that are described here, and you bow the knee to him, and you ask him for his forgiveness, and you love him, and you believe what he said, and then you have even more proof, because your life has changed. You're changed within. Your understanding is enlarged of the things that you're getting into. He answers your prayers, and you begin that walk as a believer in God, proving him over and over again. That is extremely scientific. Nothing could be more so. You need information by the fathers of modern science. What did they do? They observed. And they saw many things, phenomena, that they didn't understand. And so they said, well, the explanation of these things is unseen to us. So we will investigate them further and think about them very deeply. And if we can, we'll create these phenomena for ourselves and stir them up and by experimentation see if we can make these things happen and assist ourselves to explain them and why they happen. And they did discover more and more. And they were investigating. It's the same thing. You hear the word of God. You see that it is authentic in all that it says. You trust it. You believe in it. You follow its instructions. You respond to it. And all that it promises you is delivered. And you are changed. And you come to know God and walk with him. And so the life of proving him begins in earnest. Nothing could be more scientific than that. When we speak about faith, it's not faith in nothing. It's faith in information that God gives about himself. Recognizing its authenticity, listening, obeying, responding to it, and then receiving the fulfillment of all that it promises you. That's faith. That's how it operates. That's what it does. Now, faith is God speaking in. And here are some of the things that God's word tells us that you won't find to any satisfaction or depth in merely human literature. You have descriptions of God and his attributes. And the more you study the Bible, the more you find the description of God from cover to cover is consistent and perfect. You read about his power, his infinite power. You read about his majesty and sovereignty, his holiness and his perfection. You read about his wisdom. You read about his sovereignty, his plans and his purposes. You read about his mercy and his kindness. His holiness, of course. The fact that he cannot abide sin and wrongdoing. And he is pledged in his holy character to punish it and to destroy it everlastingly. And if you were to ask yourself, well, how can he be the holy God who is going to punish and destroy sin, and at the same time, the loving God who is ever ready to forgive and renew and restore people? You may say, well, how can God be both? He is both because he himself has made a way of salvation whereby he will come in the person of his Son Christ, not Son as we refer to a Son. He's an eternal Son who's equally God, who's equally powerful, who never been a time when he was not the eternal Son of God. Son of God came, entered into human flesh, human body and personality, and became the representative of needy man, went to Calvary's cross and suffered and died in agony to have put upon his holy soul on Calvary's cross the eternal punishment due to sinners so that he would suffer it and bear it away instead of us. that is to say, those of us who believe in him, who put faith in him, who trust him and yield to him and give our lives to him, he is the saviour of all those people. Now we only read about our need of salvation in the Bible, our sinfulness in the Bible. As human beings, we're proud creatures. We don't want to acknowledge we're sinful. We don't think about these things. Have you noticed that every time somebody famous dies, even though they may have been completely irreligious and never attended church, there'll be a funeral and their friends will get up on a platform somewhere and say, oh, they're looking down on us now from heaven. That's a big assumption, isn't it? How can you be sure that such and such a person has gone to heaven? Don't they know about a holy God? Don't they know that we are sinners? Don't they know that he cannot receive us in heaven? Don't they know that he sent a Saviour to die on Calvary to make it possible for those who repent to go to heaven? No, they don't know that. But they must have heard it 100 times. But we don't take these things in because of our proud hearts. We do not want to believe that we are sinners and we're rejected by God and we're not going to heaven, and nobody is unless they believe in Christ and trust in him alone and have his forgiveness and his mercy. You only read about this in the Bible. You don't read about it in human literature, purely human literature, because, well, that's prejudice. Human writers outside the Bible, they don't want to accept that they're sinners and we're all under judgment without the kindness of God. So I'm telling you about faith. Faith is not putting your trust in the air or in nothing. It's trusting information. Information that God gives about himself, his holiness, about the soul, about the fact that we are those who have to stand one day in judgment before a holy God and either be sent from his presence to punishment everlastingly or received into heaven and glory. Only the book of God tells us these things. But because the Bible is so deep and so full of striking and wonderfully profound matter, it is authentic to us. We believe it. It explains human nature, why we have consciences, why we fail to keep the standards that we know about. It tells us we're fallen creatures. We're seared by our sinful ways and our meanness and our dishonesty and our violence and our pride and our greed and all these things and filthiness so often. These things bring us into judgment. The Bible tells us, and we say, that's me. That's true. This is authentic information. And the information it gives about Christ that I've been talking about, and that God himself in Christ came into this world in amazing love and compassion to make it possible for me to be forgiven. That is astonishing and amazing. There is nothing like the Bible. So I believe it, and I invest my faith in it, and I trust it. It analyzes me. It speaks of me. Why? Living by sight. It's hopeless, dear friends. It is unscientific. You make up your mind. There's nothing spiritual. There's no God. There's no purpose. Everything has happened by sheer accident and chance. There is no deeper meaning. Everything can be explained in terms of particles and material explanations. You make up your mind to that. You're the one who's being unrealistic, detaching from reality, unscientific. You've just decided, closed your eyes and decided that the whole realm doesn't exist. God and eternally, and the spiritual warfare, It isn't there. You've no evidence for that. You're just refusing to look into it. That's tragic. You may be brilliant, highly gifted, intellectually capable. Why shut out all of life and the creator of the world and his purpose for you? It's a form of madness, dear friends. Don't do that with your life. Why, living by sight is foolishness. Let me give you a few simple illustrations. There was no flying by instruments. There was no radar. There was no way of telling directions in the air and all the rest of it. Years and years ago, the first pilots, they just had a look out of the cockpit and look in front of them. As they flew into cloud, they had no idea where they were. Everything had to be done by sight. Well, obviously, that put a tremendous limitation on what could be done in aircraft until the technology caught up with the ability to fly and made it possible to fly safely whether you could see or not. But being back in the early days, you were so limited. If you live by sight and material things, and you dismiss God and the Bible and information about the soul and eternity and life and how it ought to be lived, well, you limit yourself. You put yourself in a kind of primitive state. You live by sight only. You can't fly by instrument. You have no faith in God. You have no higher source of information as to the meaning and purpose of life and what God requires of you and how you may be reconciled with him and walk with him and know him. You're stuck. Same with so many other things. I often use this illustration, but many, many years ago when I was a national serviceman, I think it was about 59 or 60, there was one occasion when I happened to be observing in a demonstration of a new anti-tank weapon. And it was made by a company, a well-known company, Vickers, and it was called the Vickers Vigilant. It was a lightweight anti-tank instrument. And what it did, well, it launched a rocket bearing a shell, and it would pierce the armor of the tank and all the rest of it. But the technology wasn't advanced enough for this to find its direction entirely under radio control. And because if you radio controlled it onto its target, then in those days it could be easily jammed. The other side could send out a broad signal which would jam the whole thing. It would probably turn around and come back to you. So that was no good. So what they did, they made this anti-tank rocket launcher with a coil of copper wire rods. I'm almost embarrassed to tell you about it. It makes it sound as though I came out of the Ark. Sounds so old-fashioned. This is how it was done in the beginning of the 1960s, when it was the latest thing. And with this rapidly uncoiling copper wire, it could be guided onto its target by impulses down the wire and so on, and change direction. But sight came into it, because the person who was operating it had to sit there, rather like these chaps with their little joysticks with the toy aircraft, you know. He had to sit there and with his joystick steer this rocket-propelled shell right onto the tank. And his box was connected to it by this uncoiling wire. Of course, you didn't see it. It was all so fast. But I remember the demonstration I saw in the firing of seven shells, only one hit the target. It wasn't very good. It was good for the enemy, I suppose, but it wasn't very good for the person using it. And ultimately, these things were abandoned. But that's an illustration of life to me. If it has to be done by sight, from the day you're born to the day you die, you are so handicapped and limited and restricted in your life. No spiritual experience, no connection with God, no proving of his power, no salvation, no forgiveness of sin, no place in heaven. Your character cannot be reformed and changed by the blessing and power of God. Can't do that by yourself. There are so many disadvantages. It really is so sad, dear friends. It is not unscientific to have faith in the information about the soul and about heaven and about Christ that God gives. It's not unscientific. Well, there are many ways you can illustrate this. You have something the matter with you, you go to the hospital. I don't know much about these things, but you go to the imaging department, you get an X-ray or a CT scan, an MRI, whatever. You have these things. Well, they enable unseen things within you to be looked at and examined and found. Faith is like that. You are, these instruments are seeing what you wouldn't see without them. And when the surgeon gets to work, he finds that what the instrument said, the X-ray said, was absolutely true, we hope, and he puts it right. And I had something like this, well, about 10 years ago or less now, I suppose, because I had a heart rhythm problem. So I had to have it put right with what they call, well, had several of them, ablations. And where the cardiologist wanted to go right into the heart, into the left atrium, and with what sounded to me rather like a branding iron, a miniaturized branding iron, put his instrument onto certain areas of tissue within the heart and make a burn to stop unwanted currents rushing around. That's what it was about. Too much electrical activity. Well, how was it done? Did it cut the open? No, it was all done by catheters, and the catheters were fed in through the vein, up ventrally into the heart and into the left atrium. And then the technology inside the end of these catheters was unfolded. There was a camera there, an antennae there to read what was happening electrically. Well, how did the cardiologist know what to do? Well, he had a row of screens to look at, so he could see exactly what he was doing, and they gave him insights. And fortunately, they faithfully represented what was going on, and he could make his little burns that he wanted to do, and then everything is set to rights. Faith is like that. You are believing information, as the cardiologist was believing information displayed on the screen. And you're acting upon it, and then it's proved to you, because the promises are kept. And when God says, listen, come to me, believe in Christ, repent of your sin, yield your life to me, and you do, and your life is changed. And you walk with him and know him, and he hears your prayers and answers them, and he begins the work within you to draw you closer to himself. You're a new man, a new woman. Sin never dominates you again like it did before. You still want to battle against it. It's altogether different. But God hears your successive prayers, and you serve him, and you live for him, and you learn of him, and you love him. You believe the information. And the proof flows as the result of that. Dear friends, this is the text that I'll be looking at. For we walk by faith, not by sight. And that's what's essential for all of us. You cannot walk by sight. You've got a long journey of life in front of you. Actually, the person who walks by sight and who thinks nothing of faith has to have faith. But what a sad faith it is. If you don't believe in God, and you don't believe in Christ and his salvation and what he has done to bring about forgiveness for you, if you don't believe that you're alienated from God and you need him and you need to be reconciled with him and you need to be changed, if you don't believe those things, then what you do believe in is so inferior, because actually you have to go by belief too. What do you have to believe? To believe that there is no God, you have to believe in the most extraordinary things. That this world, I mentioned it earlier, has come into existence by pure chance, by particles of matter bumping into each other, by huge explosions and effects, by chaotic and immense things happening in the universe, as the result of which, by millions of successive chance events, you came about with all your fantastic complexity and all the amazing complexity of your biology and your emotional system and your creative abilities and your tastes. Dear friends, you have to believe that it all happened by sheer accident, and that all the apparent design in our universe, in nature, in bodily systems, all the intricacies of design are not really design at all, but somehow, pure chance. That takes a lot of believing, when you think about it. Impossible things to believe. And I often say this, but when I was a boy, they used to teach us at school, again, it's going to make me seem ancient, but when I was a boy, they used to teach us that the simplest organism known to man was something like an amoeba. And they used to say, well, this amoeba is just one cell with a nucleus and a contractile vacuole, and that's all there is to it. And that's so simple. Can't you see how easy it is to imagine that it just happened in some primeval soup one day? But now so much more is known, that simplest organism is now known to be so complicated and so full of information. Well, so now they say, oh well, this is all so complicated that the simplest form of life must have been imported from somewhere else. And now they say, and this is what all the great advocates of atheism say, now they say, it is all so complicated, it is inconceivable that life started on this planet. It's equally unlikely that it started anywhere in the solar system. So now they're telling us it started on another constellation unknown to us, unseen by us, at the present time, and floated billions of miles to Earth undamaged, and then flourished here. Got a piggyback on the back of an asteroid or something flying through space. Can you believe that? Are you ready to believe that? Because one thing is for certain, nobody thinks now that it started on this earth. It started, they think, somewhere else. It's a big ask. If you don't believe in God, you've got to believe in some incredible things to believe that anything could have happened without a desire. If you want information about God, He's provided it. We've got an authentic, credible, wonderful revelation of God, His character, His holiness, about us, our sin, our unfittedness for Him, our alienation from Him, about Christ, how He came and suffered and died in amazing love for needy sinners, about conversion, what He does in our lives when we yield to Him, about how we shall prove Him, about the hereafter and heaven, and how we shall get there, and what it will be like. This is all really coming from these simple words of the Apostle Paul. We walk by faith, not by sight. Go home tonight and pray to God for faith. Ask Him to give you faith. Ask Him to show you His word. Ask Him to show you the way. Ask Him to work in your heart so that you understand how to come to Him. And you do come to Him. And you find Him. and he changes you, and then it'll be proof after proof after proof as you walk with him as a child of God. It needs repentance, it needs faith, it needs yielding to him, and life is never the same again. For we walk by faith and not by sight.